Today begins the clinical part of the course. Thank you. Okay, today begins the clinical part of the course. What I'm doing in this lecture, which is specifically entitled General Aspects of Bacterial Pathogenesis, is to provide an overview, the big picture of the possibilities. So the point is, of course, there's going to be there are going to be some similarities among different diseases. There's also going to be a lot of differences. And what I'm trying to do is to give all the possibilities in this one lecture. Okay? So there's a lot of ground to cover. Before I forget, what I've also done, and the reason this is where it is, it specifically is not included in the first quiz, because it's absolutely ridiculous to put it in the first quiz, because at the end of the thing, I've got a list of all the major organisms that we're covering in the course. The last page of the two pages of the handout, you'll see there's a summary of the organisms that we're covering, which should be useful for review in terms of whether they're gram-positive, in terms of their morphological characteristics and some other things about them. And there's a second handout which covers, I think, almost all the exotoxins. I checked with my wife, and I think I threw Bordetella in for the first time this time. But anyway, I think we've got almost all the exotoxins that we're covering in the course in that summary table. So there's no way on God's green earth that I'm going over those two tables today, because they're summary tables of what we're going to do in the next 15 odd lectures, okay? So they're there for you as a study guide, when we get through the whole of the clinical section. You can go back to those two tables and use them to see how things are organized. And specifically, I think it'll be useful in terms of the exotoxins. Okay, so that's what the tables are for at the back. I will not be covering those today. They're there for your benefit when you start studying this stuff. All right, I'll see how I go. I may, if I get through in the hour, so be it. If I don't, I may drift a little bit into the Enterobacteriaceae lectures, because I don't absolutely need the 2 hours there. So we'll see how we go. I'm going to just go at whatever pace we go, and if I need a little more time, I'll finish the pathogenesis lecture in the second hour today. All right, so general aspects of bacterial pathogenesis. Okay. I've revised this very slightly this year again. A few words I added was, I don't think I, in the past, I haven't even bothered to put the word outbreak, epidemic, or pandemic, because I've always thought of the United States as being a pretty civilized sort of place. And pretty well, and think of, really think of the third world as being a place where you see epidemics and pandemics and what have you. But the number of times in the last few years that we have seen, and you've all seen them, anybody reads a newspaper or watches TV, the number of times we've seen outbreaks of foodborne diseases in this country, this year I think it was one point said to be tomatoes, and it turned out to be, I think, spinach. But every year it's something different. And clearly, we are seeing epidemics of contaminated food in this country at the moment. But they're not. It's a handful of people are being affected, and we're not talking about diseases like the classical plagues, where people are dying in the thousands as they might have done in the past. So anyway, I think I should. So that's something I did this year. And I think we just think of an outbreak. I've got a slide in a minute, a new slide that covers that. So we're going to go over what is a pathogen, or what isn't a pathogen for that matter. We're going to talk about outbreaks, epidemics, and pandemics, where the bacteria come from, such as the normal flora in particular, also the environment. We're going to go over general terms that we need to know about in terms of what happens in the community, in the hospitals, and various and other places, and how we use these different terms. Then we're going to talk in green. I purposely separated this out. These are the steps, the process of what may happen during an infection. And then some more possibilities. There are three different possibilities as the steps after this. But these are the various steps in the pathogenic process. And the whole point is it's not the same, of course, in every infection. And so I'm not going to be saying, this is how transmission works. So these are the possibilities. These are the ways that things can work. This is examples of adhesion. This is how it works. I'm going to explain what I mean by penetration as opposed to invasion or spread. And then I'm going to talk about tissue injury. And my wife has is covering the tip. We used to refer to them as zoonoses, the organisms where the infections start with animals. Nowadays we talk about them as bioterrorism agents. So she'll have a couple of those organisms, and she has another separate lecture on bioterrorism. And hopefully after the elections, whether it's a Republican or a Democrat, maybe the word bioterrorism will start to disappear in this country and we can move on to other things. But anyway, for the moment, bioterrorism has been a big issue, as you all know, for the last several years now. So I'll have a paragraph on that. Okay, so that's the way the lecture works. That's what we're going to be doing. So let's talk about pathogenicity. We talk about pathogenicity, the ability of an organism to infect a person. Different bacteria have different virulence factors. Yes, that's a very vague term, but we're not going to be vague. When we talk about the individual organisms, we're going to talk about the specific virulence factors in specific diseases. Now, when we talk about, we won't spend a lot of time talking about things like endotoxins and peptidoglycans, which are major virulence factors, because you all know by now from the basic part of the course that all gram-negative bacteria have got lipopolysaccharides. And you also know that all bacteria, with the exceptions of the mycoplasma and the chlamydia, have typical peptidoglycan-containing walls. So we don't have to repeat ourselves over and over again, right? Because we're going to remember the stuff that we learned in our basic lectures, so we don't have to do it every time, waste 15 minutes saying the same thing every lecture. So we're going to go over the generalities today. Virulence factors. We're going to get into both the variety of different virulence factors today. The number of initial organisms. Some bacteria are much more pathogenic than others. Sometimes you'll just get one or two organisms that you're exposed to, and it's enough to start an infection. In the other case, it may take thousands. I'm not going to really make a big deal in this course about every disease. I'm not even sure in most cases it's even really known. But as a general statement, it certainly is worthy of note that, of course, the number of organisms that you're exposed to are an issue in whether you're going to get an infection. And obviously, the more you're exposed to, the more chance you've got to get in the infection. But it is different among different organisms. And of course, the lower the number of organisms it requires to set up an infection, that is a feature of an organism being a pathogen. If it takes huge numbers of an organism to set up an infection, then by definition, it's not very pathogenic. Okay, so that's the second issue: the number of organisms in the infection, and the need for different for a smaller or a high dose to set up an infection. And then, of course, the status of the person. There are certain organisms that will basically never infect a healthy human being. I mean, it's almost unheard of for certain organisms to infect a healthy human being. Mycobacterium avium, as an example, which we all know now is the leading bacterial opportunist associated with AIDS. When I was doing my PhD, which I did between 73 and 76, I remember picking M. avium as an organism to work with because at that point, AIDS hadn't been discovered at that point, and we didn't, of course, have any association. And I remember very well thinking, hey, this is a good one to pick because it's the last case of M. avium that's probably everybody's documented, probably back in 1920. So it seemed like a good thing to sort of be working with since I was actually working in a lab in a hospital, doing research, actually physically in the hospital doing research there. So anyway, the immune status is very important, and we now know that, for example, M. avium is a big deal in AIDS because they are immunocompromised, okay? And that's why M. avium just doesn't basically infect a healthy human being. But things have changed. Now we have a worldwide AIDS epidemic, and M. avium is a big deal because of that situation, although back in 76, if you'd have said M. avium, it feels like, what are you talking about? Who cares? So the immune status is extremely important in determining whether an organism is going to cause disease or not. As I said, I decided this is a new slide this year, so it may not be perfect, but anyway, it's better than no slide at all. And I was thinking, what pathogens? What do we mean by outbreaks and epidemics and pandemics? And I think the issue is we're always going to be infected with pathogens. Large numbers of people are infected with pathogens. But that's the usual situation. It's just that's the way it is. We don't use the term outbreak, epidemic, and pandemic unless something's changed. that we're seeing something that we're not expected. It's not that they're necessarily even more important. It's just that we have a situation where we have an outbreak, a local thing, as I say, epidemic might be regional or national, a pandemic perhaps multi-country, worldwide. But we think about, we use these terms when something happened that we didn't expect. For example, you know, you don't expect to be eating some spinach and end up coming down with an enterohemorrhagic E. coli infection. Well, at least you didn't, wouldn't have expected it till the last few years. And maybe the Food and Drug Administration, the USDA, needs to do something about that. But anyway, that's the reason I think I put this in now, because we're seeing every year now, and I think what it is people are paying attention more than they used to in the past. It's not anything that's changed. We've probably had these infections for the last 30 years, last several hundred years probably. But what's changed is people are paying attention a bit more now. So that's why I've made a point of introducing these terms, because you don't think about the United States as a place where you have epidemics, quite honestly. All right, you know, but this foodborne situation, in my opinion, is making things a little different. Cox postulates. I think we can't really ignore Cox postulates. You know what they are. Although most of the time they're totally irrelevant. Cox postulates basically is how you define and really be confident that something causes a disease. For example, it should be isolated from diseased and not healthy people. If you're finding the organism has been isolated from healthy people and diseased people, and obviously it's not making any difference. So you want it to be isolated from the disease, not healthy people. You should be able to grow it in pure culture. You need an animal model. You'll be able to take that organism and put it into an animal and induce a disease in an animal that resembles the human disease. We need to be able to re-isolate it from these animals. That's the original, that's the Fox version of Cox postulates, which of course Cox put together over 100 years ago. Slightly modified, changed, and maybe simplified a little bit, but the truth of it is it isn't very relevant, because many bacterial infections and so many viral infections, even worse, we don't actually have good animal models. Okay, you can't even do this. I mean, by this definition, we would say that syphilis is actually not caused by Treponema pallidum, for example, because Treponema pallidum can't even be grown in the laboratory. Okay, so Cox postulates is something, it's worth knowing what it is, but it's not a basis to, in the year 2008, to make a decision on whether something is causing a disease or not, because we can't even grow some of the organisms, even in this day and age. Some of the major pathogens, like, just can't even, as I gave an example, Treponema pallidum can't even be grown in the laboratory. Okay, so you may be asked about Cox postulates, you know, because if say it is one of the foundations of bacterial pathogenesis, but I think you have to take it with a little bit of a pinch of salt. Okay, what we do need to know the differences between pathogens which affect healthy people and opportunistic infections, where by definition the organism is taking an opportunity. It's finding something that's different, that has allowed it to infect when it wouldn't normally be able to. It could be, for example, that there's been a knife wound. Organisms have been introduced into the abdomen, or a place where there wouldn't normally be bacteria, because of course the inside of the bacteria of the body is sterile. There are no bacteria in the true inside of the body. It could be that, for example, that you had got a cut on your skin, or somebody used a contaminated needle. Perhaps it's a drug. Perhaps it was a drug addict using a contaminated needle. But the bottom line is, there's got to be opportunistic means that there's something special going on. There's a reason beyond the norm why these bacteria are setting up an infection, and they can come from two places: the normal flora, because you're covered in bacteria, in case you didn't realize it. You're absolutely chock-a-block covered in bacteria. And from our own work, I can tell you that the air is actually full of human skin, which is covered in bacteria that you are constantly releasing. This room is chock-a-block full of shed skin covered in bacteria. Okay? So some of it comes from the normal flora, be it from the throat, be it from the urogenital area, be it the skin, what have you. That's the normal flora. People get some very strange ideas about bacteria in the environment And what you should understand is that most of the time you're pretty healthy. You're breathing bacteria the whole time, every day, day in, day out. Grams of the stuff. You're constantly breathing it. But you're fine. Well, obviously, if most environmental bacteria in general were capable of capable of causing human disease, you should all be sick as dogs at the moment. You should be laying on the ground, sort of wheezing and coughing and what have you. Okay? And that's why when people talk about cleaning surfaces and what have you in kitchens and what have you, it's sort of rather silly. You know, and there are other ways to do things. Like we have things called plates. You know, don't. But anyway, so the bottom line is environmental bacteria are generally not, they're pretty harmless. There are exceptions, and we will cover some of these exceptions in the course, like Legionella pneumophila is an example, the cause of Legionnaire's disease. Obviously, Bacillus anthracis is an example, the cause of anthrax. There are organisms in the environment that can cause human disease, but they're the exception rather than the rule. Okay, and there has to be special circumstances. Now, the thing that I want to recognize is that there's no absolutes in this world. Yes, we have to have absolutes in exams. We have to set questions whether there can only be a false or a true. It has to be that way in a multiple choice exam, but it doesn't mean it has to be that way in the real world. And of course, there's the extreme end, you've got the most pathogenic organism. And at the other extreme, you've got an organism that basically never causes an infection. You know, the organisms just basically just don't cause human disease. The archaea is an example. I don't think there's ever been a documented case, of course I'm willing to be proven wrong, but I don't believe there's been a documented case of an archaea causing a human infection, as an example. Bacillus subtilis, I think I saw maybe a paper once of one organism, there was a case reported. You just don't find these organisms causing human disease. So there's a whole range from very pathogenic, extremely pathogenic, somewhat pathogenic, slightly pathogenic, opportunistic, but an opportunistic one opportunistic organism may be very much more capable of causing an infection than another opportunistic infection. So we need to know the character, we need to know the terms, we need to understand the difference in terminology between a pathogen and an opportunist. But we also need to understand that when we look at a particular disease and a particular organism, we need to understand the situation in that specific case. Okay? All right, so we've got the general concept of pathogens or virulent organisms versus avirulent or non-virulent or opportunistic, only on these particular situations. And as I said, we're covered in bacteria, absolutely covered in bacteria. Staphylococcus aureus is actually is found in about 20% of normal healthy people, as an example. Staphylococcus epidermidis is found in most people's skins. Propionibacterium is another. You've got to understand the NIH has got a program called the Human Microbiome Project at the moment, which is the point of the program. It basically says things have changed in the last 30 years, and basically there haven't been a study with modern methods in 30 years as to what exactly constitutes the normal flora. Okay, and you might say to yourself, well, why are they spending literally tens of millions of dollars to do this if we know everything there is to know about the normal human flora? Because and obviously we don't. So we're just giving you an example of there's a few examples of organisms that are found in the flora. There are probably thousands of different species that can be found in the flora, and it varies from person to person. You know, most people have similar flora, but there will be differences between one individual and another, okay? And these are just a few examples, and they're examples because we're actually going to cover particularly Staph aureus and Staphylococcus epidermidis. We're going to cover Bacteroides. We're going to cover the Enterobacteriaceae specifically. I have lectures on that include those organisms. Okay, so opportunists can come from the environment. They can come from the air. For example, Legionella pneumophila. They can come from the water. For example, Pseudomonas aeruginosa. They could come from the soil, Bacillus cereus or Bacillus anthracis might be examples. They could come from the food, Staphylococcus aureus is an example. Am I speaking very fast here? Am I trying to make sure you aren't able to write that down? Absolutely, because we're going to be covering these things in each lecture, one at a time when we go through it. I'm just trying to give you now the overview, the big picture of what we're doing. I don't want you to try and learn the whole part of the clinical microbiology course in one lecture. It's impossible, okay? All right, so you don't need to know these examples. If there anything, again, anything's on the slides, anything's in the handouts, you're responsible for it, except for those Remember that this, again, that this is an overview lecture, and we will be covering all of the organisms mentioned in those two tables at the end. We're going to be covering them one at a time, you know, in the lectures as we go through them. So they're just there to, as a sort of a, not additional stuff, it's there to just help you, the study guides. Opportunists in the hospital. Well, obviously the opportunistic infections in the hospital are a big problem, sufficiently so that there's an actual term that's used to describe it, nosocomial. Nosocomial specifically refers to somebody who went into a hospital. They shouldn't go into the hospital because they were feeling good, but they went into the hospital because there was something major wrong with them. And then unfortunately, they caught an infection in the hospital and got worse. And that's, you know, it's very common for this sort of thing. It's not because hospitals are such horrible places and people do bad things. It's just sick people much more readily catch infections than healthy people. And if they're going to catch an infection, one good place to catch them is a hospital. Okay, so we use the word nosocomial. That's specifically when you use the word nosocomial, hospital-acquired infections. Transmission. Okay. Bacterial pathogenesis is not something vague. Bacterial pathogenesis is an interaction between a specific organism and a specific animal, a human being. Many bacteria, for example, that will infect human beings will do nothing to dogs or cats or vice versa. There are very specific organisms and specific interactions with the human host because biochemistry comes into it. It comes into there, and we will talk about the different processes as we move along. Now, the first step is transmission. Certain bacteria have basically over the years developed after millennia of interaction with human beings, and they find it that they can readily attach and adhere to the human respiratory tract. Okay? That's why it's important that they be transmitted in airborne droplets. If they're transmitted, for example, in the food, it's not going to do squat because they're probably not going to, it's the wrong way for these organisms. They're in the wrong place to set up an infection. Okay? There are other organisms that do very well in the food. They can, for example, resist the acid pH of the stomach. Helicobacter pylori is such an example. Again, in the same sort of way that we're going to catch something from a food, you could catch it in a similar way from the water, except it has to be an organism that can survive well in a liquid form, as opposed to something else we might do much better if it's in a more dry form than food. Sexual contact. Okay, so these are all possibilities. We're not saying every organism can infect by any of these routes. Each specific species, or some instance strains within a species, have adapted to be able to infect in a certain way, and they need to be transmitted in a certain way, because the first place they're going to come in contact with the human being, they're going to stick there, they're going to attach. And if they're in the wrong place, they're not going to have that option. Okay, so transmission between person to person, or from the food or the water or what have you, that's the first step in the process. We need to think about these organisms. Are we dealing with a respiratory pathogen? Are we dealing with a food-borne organism? Are we dealing with an organism that's transmitted through sexual contact? These are the sorts of things we need to know about these organisms. And of course, depending on how we're exposed to them, the non-specific defenses are going to be quite different. Peristalsis is very important in getting rid of organisms, passing them, you know, out through the body, so they don't have a chance to stick around. The respiratory tract. Ciliary action is pretty good at pushing bacteria back up after they've got into the respiratory tract. The ciliary are very good about pushing them back out again, so they can be swallowed and then get into the intestine and remove that way. Coughing and sneezing is there for a reason. It's an attempt to get rid of these bacteria. Not very successful a lot of the times, but that's what coughing and sneezing is like. We're trying to get rid of these bacteria. The urogenital tract, urination, is a great way of washing things out. Okay, so there are non-specific host defenses, and of course there are things that go way beyond this. You know, there are sort of, in immunology, I'm sure they went into some greater detail in terms of the non-specific immune system, so I don't need to do that again. Okay, so the first step is transmission. How do you get exposed in the first place? The second step is adhesion. And that's the point. You really need to understand that this is a very specific process. It's not just a matter of any old bacteria just happens to sort of end up somewhere and just be there. There are specific interactions between adhesins and receptors. And these are terms that you need to know. There will be components on, for example, certain epithelial cells, which will be recognized by certain proteins, or they may not be, they may be glycoproteins, they may be carbohydrates or glycolipids, what have you. But there are certain molecules that will be on a bacterial surface that will be that will bind to other receptors on the surface of the epithelium. It's sure not the case a lot of times that the human body wants this to happen. I mean, you know, the opposite. I mean, we want that it doesn't happen. We want these bacteria to go away, and we don't have anything to do with them. But anyway, regardless, there will be an interaction between molecules, and I'll just call them as a receptor for simplicity. But there's molecules on the surfaces of the surfaces where bacteria first come into contact with the human host, where these molecules will be recognized, and the bacteria adhere through these adhesin receptor interactions. And I'll give a couple examples in a minute, and I'll give some other examples probably as we go through the course. To take one example, one of the best studied ones is for Streptococcus pyogenes. And I am going to go a little fast because I have a whole lecture on streptococci, and about 90% of that is on Streptococcus pyogenes, so we have some other time to spend on this. This is not the last time you're going to see the group A Streptococcus. But for example, there are molecules on the surface called the F protein because it binds to fibronectin. There's also some of these lipotychoic acids that I've mentioned before. I said to you earlier that lipotychoic acids are actually membrane molecules, but it just so happens that in the case of the group A Streptococcus, some of the lipotychoic acid actually extends outside the cell and is actually exposed on the cell surface. And so it's been suggested that both the lipotychoic acid and the F protein are involved in adhesion of the Streptococcus pyogenes to the respiratory epithelium. And they bind, and what's happened here is it's fibronectin that's adhered to the epithelial cells. The fibronectin is really essentially the receptor here, and this is the adhesin side of it. Okay, so that's a specific interaction. It's not something vague, okay? You know, there's no F protein or no lipotychoic acid. They're not going to interact with fibronectin in this instance. This is a useful slide that I put in here, actually, because I think it nicely shows the difference between what the fimbriae look like and the flagella. Because fimbriae, it's particularly here because it's the fimbriae that are particularly involved in adhesion. Okay? But this slide also is nice because it shows very nicely, there's of course an electron micrograph because you'd never see this sort of thing under a light microscope. And this is sort of from Dennis Kunkel's site, who has all sorts of wonderful electron micrograph pictures and has kindly agreed to let this school and my other places use them for free. He does charge for it. But anyway, we get a free deal here, which is nice. And this shows you what the flagella look like, extending out from the back of an enterohemorrhagic E. coli. And the fimbriae, on the other hand, are these very thin things that are just this fluffy sort of thing that's on the surface. Okay, so that really clearly shows you clearly more that what a fimbriae, the singular being fimbrous, the singular for flagella being flagellum. It shows you the difference between what a flagellum versus what a fimbrous looks like. Okay? All right, but that's the adhesins would be in the fimbriae. That's why this slide is in this particular place. Okay, so coming back to these fimbriae, there are a whole host of different molecules made by different E. coli that are involved in adhesion. And I just give two examples here. One of them is where the adhesin is made up, is actually, the receptor is actually mannose. What that mannose is part of, your guess is as good as mine. Could be glycoproteins, could be glycolipids. But anyway, mannose is exposed on the surface of many human cells. And these fimbriae recognize mannose. They're referred to in this instance as type 1 fimbriae. On the other hand, if they recognize galactose, which is much more clearly defined as being part of glycolipids and glycoproteins, but if they recognize galactose, they're referred to as P fimbriae. And the major reason I'm putting this up here again is to stress the specificity of the adhesion process, that it's not something, you know, it's not something vague, it's not non-specific interactions, it's a specific interaction of a specific molecule on the surface of a bacterial cell interacting with specific molecules on the surfaces, usually the of an epithelial surface. Okay? And we will cover this again when I get to my E. coli lecture. We'll probably put this same slide up again. Okay, so that's the second stage of the process, transmission, adhesion, okay? But that's not the end of the process. Some bacteria are perfectly happy staying put. For example, traditional strains of the group A streptococcus that call strep throat, until the last 15, 20 years or so, were almost always non-invasive organisms. And they were quite happy staying put in the throat. Things have changed. We'll get to that in my streptococcus lecture. I give other examples here. Vibrio cholerae, the cause of cholera, adheres to the epithelium in the gut. The species Salmonella enteritidis actually penetrates into the epithelium. You could use the word invade there. I try very hard to not be confusing as to when I use the term penetration invasion. When you take the national boards, I don't control what faculty do in medical schools all over the country. They may not use the word penetration and invasive in exactly the same way that I use it. The point is, you need to understand what the question's all about. And the question is, are you talking about penetration into an epithelium or invasion into an epithelial cell? Or are you talking about a situation where it's got beyond the epithelial cell and got into the bloodstream or the lymphatics and has spread? Okay? And sometimes people aren't very clear when they use these words. I will be clear in this course. I can assure you that. But the point is, if you read the question carefully, you'll know when somebody's talking about penetration into an epithelium and you'll know when they're talking about whether we're talking about invasion beyond these surfaces. And that's really the point. What is the disease all about? Is it a local thing where they just live on the surfaces? Do they actually get inside the cells and stay put? Do they go beyond? And different diseases, different things happen. And sometimes it's different strains within the same species, different things may happen. Okay? So we'll get into this again, more specifics. I have a gastrointestinal lecture. Thanks. It starts at 11 o'clock. So we'll get into some of this then. Okay, connective tissue destruction. Now, if an organism actually gets into the tissue proper, such as a wound, if it's able to get beyond the local site that it's at, where it is, well, that means that's a great opportunity for these bacteria, because it means instead of just infecting a few organisms in one place, they got the whole body to infect. So if an organism can go beyond where it is, that's great as far as the bacterial cells are concerned. It's a whole body of food to deal with instead of just a tiny bit of skin or a tiny bit of pus or something. And some bacteria make enzymes that are actually involved in chewing up connective tissue. And one example is collagenase that chews up collagen. And another one is hyaluronidase that chews up hyaluronic acid, two of the major components of connective tissue. Okay? Just examples here. Now, once the organism has... If it's an organism that's just living outside, living on the skin, for example, there are no lymphocytes roaming around on the skin. You're not asking a question, are they extracellular pathogens or not? I mean, there's no debate. They're free. They're living on a surface here. But once an organism gets into the bloodstream or the lymphatics or gets into the tissues proper, it's got to deal with the immune system. And there are different ways that the organism can deal with the immune system. And it's different for different organisms. Some organisms are very good at living in the bloodstream. They can resist the various noxious things that are present in the bloodstream. So they may be quite happily living extracellularly. If they get taken up by a white blood cell, on the other hand, they may be killed almost immediately. An example is Staphylococcus aureus, which is an extracellular pathogen, which is great as long as it's outside a white blood cell. But once it gets inside a neutrophil, it's a very unhappy camper. So that's an extracellular pathogen, an organism that would prefer, its host defenses are designed to avoid being phagocytosed, to stay outside of the neutrophils and macrophages. So they're resistant to extracellular killing. They are killed on phagocytosis. They resist killing by avoiding internalization. Okay, and I've just given you an example, Staphylococcus aureus. In fact, here's another example of the specificity of pathogenesis, that it's not just something vague. One of the best examples of avoiding phagocytosis is the protein A that's produced by Staphylococcus aureus. Staphylococcus aureus secretes a bunch of protein, what's called protein A. Protein A binds to the Fc portion of immunoglobulin. And so what happens is, if you've got an organism and it's been exposed to an immune person, an antibody might well stick to these bacteria. And it's common to have antibodies against, for example, staphylococci, because we're exposed to staphylococci our whole lives. They live on the surface of the skin and also in the nares. It's not uncommon you're going to see such antibodies. Protein A binds to the Fc portion. Now, in order for bacteria to be taken up by white blood cells, as you know from the immunology part of the course, they're taken up through Fc receptors or through complement receptors. Well, if the protein A is stuck on the surface there, it's blocking the interaction of the immunoglobulins, or the complement for that matter, if it's attached to these antibodies. It's blocking the interaction of these bacteria with these antibodies stuck on them with the white blood cells. So here's a very specific example of a pathogenesis factor made by an organism to try and resist killing by neutrophils and macrophages. Another excellent example is the M protein made by, again, the group A streptococcus. And I've just give you one example here. I'm going to give you two other situations in the streptococcus lecture, okay, beyond this. This is a situation what we have in a normal person. This is actually the situation in a test tube, but I'm going to show you two other examples when I get to my streptococcus lecture. And the point is this: peptidoglycan is very good at binding complement. If you just take some free peptidoglycan and there's nothing else around, it loves to bind complement. It activates the alternate complement cascade. I'm sure you have that in immunology already. Now, what that means is that if there was a bare peptidoglycan here, then the peptidoglycan would be covered in components of the complement cascade. Therefore, this organism could be taken up through complement receptors on white blood cells. Well, instead, what happens is the M protein of the organism is very good, very effectively binds fibrinogen, which what happens is the fibrinogen then coats the M protein and blocks the complement from coming into contact with the peptidoglycan. Okay, so that's what happens in a test tube. Now, I'll give you some other examples when I get into the pathogenesis lecture in immune individuals and how we get around this process. Because if we couldn't get around this process, then we'll be killed by group A streptococci, or at least the invasive forms of them. Okay, so that's another example of a specific molecule that's involved in stopping and interfering with an organism that prefers to grow extracellularly. Interferes with it being taken up and being killed on phagocytosis. Now, other organisms are the exact opposite. The mycobacteria are an excellent example. This Mycobacterium tuberculosis is an example. It causes TB, or consumption, as it used to be called. And in this instance, all these intracellular parasites are the exact opposite. They do not want to live outside cells. They don't grow very well outside cells. They need stuff. They need stuff from the host to grow. They want to be phagocytosed. But if they're phagocytosed and they can't deal with their enzymes that are present in the lysosomes or fused phagolysosomes, if they can't deal with these enzymes, then they're going to be killed. So an intracellular pathogen is the exact opposite to an extracellular pathogen. It's an organism that wants to be taken up, desires to be taken up, because it has defense mechanisms by which it can neutralize the attempt by the host to kill them. And there are three different situations with intracellular pathogens. One situation is where there's, if there's no fusion of the phago lysosome, as soon as organisms are exposed to a macrophage, it may set off a sort of a burst of free radicals that could kill this organism. But there are a lot of enzymes are present in lysosomes that will kill these bacteria, and if they stay inside a phagosome, they're fairly well protected. So if they can inhibit phagolysosome fusion, that's a good mechanism. Now sometimes, however, they don't have a way of stopping this fusion of occurring. Okay, in that instance, they've got to absolutely be resistant. So in this instance, they don't have to be resistant to the enzymes because the bacteria are in one place and the enzymes are somewhere else. If the fusion actually occurs, however, these bacteria have got to be resistant to these lysosomal enzymes. So it's a quite different situation. On the other hand, some of the organisms covered by Dr. Mayer actually managed to escape from these phagolysosomes and end up in the cytoplasm. And that's a great place to be if you're interested in the parasite, because there's nothing there to kill you. Okay? So there are three distinct processes here that can occur for intracellular parasites. The mechanisms are quite different of how you kill these bacteria. So it's, in the case of an extracellular parasite, and I'm using the word parasite in a generic sense here, and I'm talking about bacteria, not true parasites that you've had in the early part of your course. But in the generic sense, killing of these intracellular bacterial parasites, if they're taken up inside cells, the way you want to kill them is through cell-mediated immunity. And that, for example, is the hallmark of tuberculosis. If an organism is, however, extracellular and is able to stay extracellular, then, of course, cell-mediated immunity is not an issue. They're going to be hopefully killed off by antibodies. Okay, so things are different, and we need to know with these. Are we talking about intracellular parasites or extracellular parasites? Okay, so these are, so far we've had transmission, adhesion, whether they stay local, whether they penetrate locally, whether they invade and get into the bloodstream, whether they end up in the serum or the plasma. Whether they end up inside cells, and then so far, all we've said is we haven't said anything about infectious diseases at all. What we've spoken about so far is infection, because infection simply is what it says. It means an organism is growing in your body. Doesn't mean you're sick. I mean, there are lots of viruses that sort of. That are quite laid dormant, quite harmlessly for years, and you don't even know you've even got an infection. An infectious disease, what it really means is that an organism is growing in you, but it's not just growing in you or on you, it's actually doing some damage to you. There are specific mechanisms of tissue injury, and they fall into three categories: exotoxins, endotoxins, and specific immunity. An exotoxin, we'll define them one at a time. As I said, I'm not going to rush with this. If we don't get done by 10:02, I will continue with this lecture after the hour. But we're getting close to the end of it. Okay, now, there are three different possibilities. Exotoxins are proteins, usually enzymes. You should never confuse an exotoxin with an endotoxin. Endotoxins refer specifically to lipopolysaccharide. I didn't use that term when we discussed it in the basic part of the course, because we were dealing about the structures that are present in bacteria. We weren't dealing with how they damage the host, which is the purpose of this lecture. Okay, so lipopolysaccharides and I'm not going to go over again the structure of what a lipopolysaccharide is and all the rest of it. You need to go back to some more information in your earlier handout. But again, as I said earlier, it is the lipid A component of lipopolysaccharide is the primary component that activates the production of various cytokines and what have you, such as tumor necrosis factor and interleukin-1, as just examples. That would be an example of activation of non-specific immunity, because we're not actually seeing specific cells are recognizing specific antigens, we're seeing non-specific activation of large chunks of the immune system. Specific immunity also plays a role. For example, Mycobacterium tuberculosis, the cause division of TB, doesn't produce any exotoxins to speak of. If it was growing in your body in fairly not in huge numbers, you probably wouldn't even be aware that it was there. Unfortunately, your immune system doesn't like things growing in your body and tends to produce a response to it. And it's the cell-mediated immune response in that situation where the host is attempting to kill the organism and not succeeding, or maybe just limiting its numbers, and you, the innocent bystander, your tissues are the innocent bystander, and you get damaged. Okay? So these are specific diseases. And in the case of exotoxins, we're going to talk a lot about exotoxins in this course. It's not because exotoxins are any more important than endotoxins or specific immunity. It's that specific organisms produce specific exotoxins because they're enzymes. And they're different. Every one of them is different to every other one. So we have to spend a lot of time talking about exotoxins. There's only one type of endotoxin, which is lipopolysaccharide, and I have mentioned in the handout, we'll mention again later, that certain other bacterial molecules, such as the peptidoglycan, have endotoxin-like activity. But lipopolysaccharide is a lipopolysaccharide, and a peptidoglycan is a peptidoglycan, generally speaking. Maybe there's an exception my wife gets to tracheal cytotoxin and Bordetella pertussis. But generally speaking, lipopolysaccharide is lipopolysaccharide, peptidoglycan is peptidoglycan. If you say it for one organism, you've said it for all of them. But when you talk about an exotoxin, every case you've got to know the specific mode of action of that particular exotoxin and what it's doing in that particular disease. Okay? So that's why we spend so much time on it. It's not that it's any more important. So exotoxins are always proteins. If you hear the word lipopolysaccharide, if you hear the word carbohydrate coming into it, you cannot be talking about an exotoxin. They're proteins, and they're almost always enzymes. There are exceptions to every rule, and I'll give one or two examples as we go along. But they're always proteins, and the vast bulk of the time, they're enzymes. They can destroy cellular structures, or they can destroy the extracellular matrix. And in a sense, you could consider hyaluronidase and collagenase that I already mentioned. You could consider them, I suppose, in a sense, an exotoxin. But regardless, exotoxins are destructive. They destroy things. They damage things. They damage cells. They kill cells. Okay, that's what an exotoxin is, and that's why we have to speak so much about them, because of the mode of action of different exotoxins is quite different from one organism to the next. A term that's commonly used is an AB toxin, and I don't know if anybody ever intended it this way when they came up with the term. But I think it's useful to think about the A as standing for active and the B as standing for binding. It's a good way to remember it. And basically, exotoxins tend to have two components. One component, the binding component, recognizes a cellular structure, or for that matter, an extracellular structure, but usually a cellular structure. And the active component does the damage. Now, of course, if it's trying, for example, to get at a ribosome, if that active component is sitting outside and the ribosome's in here, isn't going to do very much. So the purpose of the binding component is to get the exotoxin in contact with the cell so that the active component can get where it needs to get. If it's on a membrane, well, that's fine because it's already binding to a membrane. But if it needs to get at a ribosome, for example, two of the major places that these exotoxins act, then that active component has got to get inside the cell. And there are mechanisms to do that. The exotoxin actually has been designed that way, if you like, to allow that these active components to be internalized. These will be the enzyme part. Okay, so most exotoxins, not all, but most exotoxins are AB toxins. To take an example, I tend to cover these two together for no good reason other than the fact that it means you only have to learn something once instead of twice. Both diphtheria toxin and Pseudomonas exotoxin A have basically the same mode of action. They both, ADP ribosylate, elongation factor 2, one of the proteins involved in protein biosynthesis. They inhibit protein biosynthesis, which of course kills the cell. Now, does that mean that it's exactly the exotoxin is equally important in diphtheria and Pseudomonas aeruginosa infections of the lung? Absolutely not, which is why we're going to discuss them separately. Diphtheria is one of the classical agents of plague, and you've all been immunized against diphtheria, because that's what kills you, this particular exotoxin. In the case of Pseudomonas, it does produce this enzyme. Whether it's important, really that important in pathogenesis, your guess is as good as mine. So we need to know that there are exotoxins produced that have similar modes of action, but we also need to know that the diphtheria toxin, and I will have a lecture on diphtheria, and I will stress this again. I also will have a lecture on Pseudomonas, and I will stress it again there. So again, we're not expecting everything to be learned in this one slide. I'm just introducing you, softening you up, letting it sink in a little bit. Then we get it the second time, then it will really sink in. Okay, let's have a break for 10 minutes, and I'll come back to this point on the hour. Okay.